Today, let's talk about five fancy Power Apps functions. All right, there's nothing really fancy about them, but the idea is these are five functions I think you all need to know, but you don't tend to watch things. If I'm like, hey, we're gonna do a video about beep, you're like, eh. But so what we're gonna do is I'm gonna go over these five functions that I love so much that I think you need to know. I'm gonna show you quickly how to use each one, give you some examples of where they might integrate into your stuff. Sound fun? Then let's just switch over to my desktop and take a look. All right, so first off, let's start with one that I think almost none of you ever use, and that is one called Coalesce, right? So what Coalesce does, let's insert ourselves a label real quick, is it returns the first non-blank value. Okay, so what that means, like if I do this and I say Coalesce, and then I did doom doom nothing, and then I said hi, it's gonna return hi, because that first parameter there is completely blank, and so it returns the first one that's not blank, right? So to make a little more sense, like if we throw a text input over here, so if you go here and change this to be text input one dot text, okay, so right now it has text input in there, so it shows up, and we'll change hi to be NA, and we don't want to insert another text input, right? Just so you can kind of see this thing in its full glory. So now I got text input one, text input two, and so then we'll go right here because it can take as many parameters as you want. So we'll say text input two dot text, and then NA. Okay, as long as they're all the same type of data. So right now it is showing you the one from text input one because that is the first one there. So if we say play, if we blank that out, now it's showing text input two because that's what's down here. Get that out, there's NA, right? If we go here and we're to the one, you see one, we put a two, that doesn't change it because the first non-blank thing was text input one. But if we delete the one, we get the two. And then of course, if we delete the two, we go back to NA, right? So Coalesce is a great way for you to get the first non-blank value. Now, this could, you know, this is very simple. This is just using a control, but you could be doing a data source lookup or other fancy stuff, right? So speaking of fancy stuff, so one of my favorite ways to use this is let's go ahead and add a data source. So we're gonna add my SharePoint employees list. So I'll kind of edit this out real quick, hang on. Okay, so now we have a data source. This could be SharePoint, Dataverse, SQL, doesn't matter. But if we throw over here and insert ourselves a button, how often do you have code that might look something like this? So what we're doing here, right? We're saying, hey, do a lookup. Go look up in our employees list to see if the first name equals Nicola one. If that is blank, then do this patch. If that is not blank, right? So then do this patch. We're gonna do this lookup again, right? You see the redundancy here? You're doing two of the same exact lookup and you've got a lot of code written here, okay? But what you can do with something like this, once you understand Coalesce, is what if we did this? Copy, paste the button. What if instead of all this, I'm gonna take the lookout out. So I'm gonna copy that, copy. And now we're gonna get rid of all the whole if, and we're gonna get rid of the whole second patch. And we're gonna say, hey, patch employees. And then here we're going to say Coalesce. And then we're gonna put in our patch, or sorry, our lookup. And then we're gonna put in our defaults. And then we'll close our cute little thing like that, okay? So now what does this say? It says, hey, patch employees, Coalesce, so find the first non-blank value. So do this lookup. If this lookup is blank, then don't patch it, right? Because you can't patch blank, so then do defaults. But if it finds Nicola, right? So if we took off the one here and did that, then it would patch that just fine, right? So this is an interesting way to think about this, right? Anytime you have any type of if statement where you're checking to see if something's blank, but you're gonna reuse that blank thing, a lot of times you can adapt it and use Coalesce, right? So once you get comfortable with this function, this is much cleaner as long as you understand how it works. This is less typing, less chance for typos, less repetition. I really like using Coalesce in scenarios like this, along with scenarios like this where you might be saying, hey, you know, maybe you're doing a bunch of text inputs, and if they leave any of them blank, you want to automatically set it to NA. But you don't want to put NA in the box, so that'll confuse the user. So you just say, hey, if they left that text input blank, then put NA here, right? So all of a sudden here, right, now do you understand how that works? Maybe in here for the title, you're pulling this out and you're saying, hey, if they put something in text input one, make that the title. If they put it in text input two, make that the title. If they didn't put either one, do NA. So once again, giving you this ability to make decisions and kind of just write an if statement without having to do it, right? So that's my first fancy function, Coalesce. All right, for the second one, let's create ourselves another new screen here. So for this one, we're actually gonna do two functions at once. So first off, I wanna throw a gallery in here. right? Gallery just wants a table, doesn't care how it gets there. We're going to change this gallery just to be a simple title. So we're going to say, hey, for your items, I want you to be sequence. Sequence is a function that you give it a number. So in this case, we'll give it 10, and it creates a table, right? Data type table with a column name value, and then the numbers 1 through 10, right? So if we go in here, like, let's kind of update this thing real quick. We'll pull this over some, and we'll set this to say value. So this is a great way if you're going to get something from your user. Maybe they're giving you an indeterminate number and you need to create reservation slots based on the number they gave you. Or you need to cycle through, right? You need to count stuff and then show them that, right? Sequence is awesome because it now gives us the power to generate a table automatically to a set number, right? Now, with this though, you can do fancier. So that's just giving us 1 to 10, right? If we scroll, you can see there's 10 here. We'll change it to 5 so we can always see them, okay? So that's 5. Now you could also, maybe for your scenario, you want to start at a different number, right? So I could say start at 0. So 5, 0, now it does 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? That's 5 rows, the first row being 0. Fun. You can also set the increments. So if we change this to 10, now it's 0, 10, 20, 30, 40. This gives you a lot of flexibility for creating dynamic tables of data, right? Now, once you understand how sequence works, and remember, these are just numbers. So I could be looking these up from a database. I could be getting them from a text input. I could be doing math, right? It doesn't matter how you get to those numbers. Just put the numbers there that you want, right? Like if we come over here and just say, insert ourselves a text input, right? So this is text input 3. So then now we can just go here and say, you know what? For this step, we want to do text input 3, input 3 dot text. Now wrap that in a value function, right? Because you want it to turn the text number into a number we're about to give it. So we'll do something like that. And now if we go over here and hit play and we type in 3 or 4, I type in 4, right? There they are. If we change this from 4 to 2, now we got 2. We do 0, we got none, 1, etc. Right? Now to stop them from typing a some text in there, right? We could then just take this and say change your format to number. Now they can only do that. And then you could even, if you want to get fancy, maybe you want to, don't want them to have 0. You could do like Coalesce or something. Just say, hey, if they don't give us anything, make it 5. It's up to you. Okay. But the other thing that you can do, now that you understand how sequence works, we're going to do our third fancy function. And that is one of our data shaping functions called AddColumns. So in this scenario, what I really want to do is I want to get the next 5 Fridays, right? And so today's Thursday, so we know that that would be, the next 5, right? So we'll put 5 over here. Let's go back, go hit play. Okay, so we need 5 in there. Now, this is just numbers. How do I change this table to be dates? So you can't change the sequence per se. You can't say sequence spit out dates. But what we're going to do is we're going to say, I want you to take that and I want you to add columns. So add columns. What that will do is take a table, sequence put out a table. We're going to create a column called my date. And then here we're going to say, you know what I want you to be? I want you to be today. And then plus value, which is the number that got produced out of sequence. Okay. So now if we go down here and say, hey, edit this, insert ourselves another label. And here we're going to say my date. Perfect. Right. Kind of pull these something. I don't know. It doesn't matter. But look, so now because today is the 3rd, or no, today's the 4th, since today is the 4th, right? So 1, 4 plus 0 is that, boom, 114, 124, boom, 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 right? We probably want to change this to 7s. And then since today's Thursday, we actually want to make this start at 1. So there you go. So there's the next 5 Fridays, right? 1, 5, 112, 119, 126, and 22. Ta-da! So once you start understanding that, hey, sequence can produce numbers, fancy function, and then add columns gives you a way to shape the table that came from that, you can do some really cool stuff, right? And add columns has a bunch of friends. It has rename columns, drop columns, show columns, right? There's a bunch of other data shaping ones, but most often I find myself just need to add a column because I want to pre-calculate something. I want to create something like this. But well, bonus tip here, like if you didn't want the value column to come through, you just only wanted the table to have the single column, right? Then we could just go here and say show columns, put our add columns back because the new formula bar likes to hide stuff. And then we'd say, just show my date. And look, now it errors because value's not there. If we look at the table, it only has the my date column. Okay. So, but we're not doing show columns now, so I'll stop that. But I wanted you to kind of see the fun that we could have there. Oh, and I can't even hit delete all the way. There we go. Okay. Now, if you want a bonus tip or a bonus challenge, right? So I'm not going to show you how to do it, but what would be really fun is if you can go and figure out, like, so I cheated, right? So today's Thursday, so I knew today plus one was Friday, right? How could you figure out, though, what day of the week today was? So if today was Monday, how could you automatically have it show me all the Fridays, right? I'll give you a hint. There's a function out there called weekday, but I'd like you guys to try to solve that yourselves. And just leave in the comment the formula. It should be a pretty big formula, very similar to this, but right here we've got the one, you're going to have some additional logic, right? So put it out there. I will definitely check in the comments and I will be happy to thumbs up or heart the people that get it right so that those of you that have no idea how to do it, you can see that. Cool? Yeah, thought it'd be a new little twist here. Okay, so that's three fancy functions, two more to go. Now, before we jump into the next fancy function, I did want to remind you about Power Platform University. Right, that is a 6-month live immersive program with me and a personal mentor for you from our team. It's got exams, it's got hands-on projects, it's got all these different unique classes, everything that you need to be awesome at Power Platform, right? It is the same training that we use to put our new consultants through so that they are awesome for all the consulting projects we do. And so we make that available. So go over to training.powerapps911.com and check out Power Platform University so you can learn really cool stuff like this and hang out with me. All right, back to our fancy function. All right, the next one, not the most exciting function either. And I probably don't use it the way you think too often, but I wanted you to know it was here either way. All right, so let's insert ourselves a button. And so that is the notify function, right? So notify function is the ability to say, hi, mom, in your Power App, right? So now if we take that and we hit play, when I press this button, we're going to get a little pop-up that says, hi, mom. I know, super exciting, right? So this is a way for you to notify your users without creating that big old modal or pop-ups that we all like to do. So what you can do now is you can go down here. And so if you understand that that's how it works, right? There's a couple little caveats. So you have text up to 500 characters. And by default, it'll go away after 10 seconds, but we can adjust all that. So the first thing we might want to adjust is the notification type. All this is really doing is changing the color of the notification, right? So error is red, warning is yellow, success is green, information is what it defaulted to, which was that white, right? So if you just change this to be, you know, error, now they're going to be red. And if you do a comma, then you can set how long you want it to go away. So this is in milliseconds. So like if I wanted this to go away after, you know, half a second, right? We just do 500 milliseconds. Now, if we go back over here and hit play, when we press the button, not only are we going to see the red, but after a half a second, it goes away, right? So you do have the ability to control that stuff. Now, honestly, most of the time, if I want to notify my users, I am most likely creating a modal, that whole pop-up, you know, where we do a container. I'll put a video link up there if you haven't seen it before, but you can put a whole container over the screen, big message, formatted buttons, all that stuff, right? Where notifications work are either little notifications, like you really are just trying to give them a little snippet of like, hey, success, and you don't want to write all that interface. Still don't do it a lot, but you could. Where I will find myself sometimes using this, though, is I use this a lot of times in troubleshooting, right? Because sometimes when I'm troubleshooting like long code, a big chunk of code, when I'm trying to do that, and in the middle there, I want to make sure that like a variable is getting set or something, the loop is happening, I will put notifies in there as a troubleshooting step so I can see on the screen what's going on, right? The same way I like to put labels on the screen to show things, but sometimes because of all the moving parts, a label doesn't work as well in some scenarios for me. So notify for me is mostly a troubleshooting tool. You don't have to use it that way. You can use it any way you want, but I just want to kind of throw it out there that I think a notify is a way for Shane to get a pop-up when he's trying to figure out what he broke more than the users. I like to build the whole big modal. Last but not least in our fancy functions is going to be the one that is most dear and near to my heart. It is the with function. All right, so let's make ourselves a new screen. And so for the with function, what I want to do is we're going to build a little quick demo, right? So we're going to insert ourselves a date picker, and then we're going to insert ourselves another date picker. And then now I'm going to rename this. I'm going to do DP start and then DP end, like so. So I've got those both renamed. And then I'm going to write a formula in a label. So hang on one sec. Okay, I didn't think you needed to see me write that whole formula, but there it is. And so what this formula does is it spits out the number of weeks and days between two dates, right? Because date diff doesn't do weeks and days. It can do dates, months, weeks, or years and all that, but it doesn't do weeks and days like this. So I wrote a formula for it. So now if we hit play and I change this to be like the 29th and say, okay, there is 3 weeks and 4 days between those two dates. Awesome. So, but if you look at my formula here, it's very repetitive. So the way that that works, right, is I do a date diff between the two, and then I use this mod function of not date diff to get the seven, that's kind of the remainder, subtract it out so the seven subtracts cleanly. And then I do a mod here again, date diff again. So I've got three date diffs, two mods, very repetitive. Now you're thinking, Shane, I could do it more efficiently. That's great. This is a teaching example. Don't overcomplicate this. Okay. But what the with function does is it allows me to generate that stuff and reduce redundancy, right? So if we go up here, we're going to just type in with, and then we're going to put it in curly brackets, and then we're going to say X total days, like so. And so what we want to do here for X total days is we're then going to grab this date diff. I don't want to rewrite it because I'll screw it up. You know that. We'll do that. We'll paste that in. We'll close our curly. And then we will do a comma. So now everywhere after this comma, until we get to the closing parenthesis, which we're going to put at the end, that is available. So now there is a, think of X total days as a variable that only exists between that parenthesis right there and that parenthesis right there. Okay. But now what I can do is I can take this, I could copy, and I can go in here and basically say, hey, everywhere that I had date diff, now we can put that in, right? So there's that one. There's that one. And finally, there's that one. Okay. So look, now we got X total days minus mod total days, seven, blah, 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 right? So we've still got the redundant mods, but we're a little bit closer. So what's really cool with though, is you can nest with inside of with. So watch this. We're going to copy this whole mod X total days thing, copy. And then we're just going to, we'll hit enter here to make this easier for us to read. We're going to do another with inside here. And we're going to say X leftovers, leftover days, whatever, right? We'll paste that in. We'll close our curly again. We'll do our comma. And then we'll go down here. And now, right, it's happy. But now we got this, so we can copy this out. And then we'll do here, everywhere we have mod, we'll replace that with this. And now look, now you can see that it's really just total days minus leftover days. So that's how we got down to 21, right? Because I think there's 25 total. So 21 divided by 7, that gave us the 3 weeks. And then leftover days is 4. And so 4 days between the two dates. So notice here, this reads easier. And instead of doing 5 things, we did 2 things, right? Because we did the one thing 3 times, the one thing twice. But we're able to use with to repeat that. And by nesting the one with inside the other, I have the ability here to reference the output of this first one in the second one, right? Because you keep in mind, you could in with, you could have 2 things. Like we could just be like, you know, X message, hi, right? So you could have 2 or 3 or 10 of those inside there if you really wanted to. But if you want to reference the one from the other, then what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to put those inside here, right? Because this X total days exists after this comma through that close quote, or no, this close quote for close parenthesis, right? And then X leftover days exists after this comma through that parenthesis right there. So that's what you want to be kind of thinking about, right? Is like the way that these guys all correlate like that. So there you go. 5 very fancy functions that I think your Power Apps would be better. You'd have an easier time writing and doing things if you understood those. So hopefully by using the word fancy, I got you all to watch this. But what are your favorite functions, right? If I was going to do another video like this, what functions would you like to see? Leave them in the comments below. Happy to do that, take these on. Maybe there's controls. Maybe we should do 5 fancy controls. Oh, that could be a good video. I don't know. You tell me. Okay? And with that, I'm going to say thanks and have a great day.